I've encountered another rumor regarding the Deepkin. A sailor in Port Helleray drunkenly regaled me with tales of how eyeless elves rose from the sea, riding flying eels and sharks to attack a local village. His wild claims were hard to believe, but the look in his eye told me there must be some truth to the horrors that he spoke of. These rumors will require further investigation.
Hey guys, Caro here, and before we get started, I wanted to give credit where credit is due, because I did not come up with the original idea for this. That glory goes to my cousin Kyle, who in his first attempt at being a DM decided to attack one of the biggest challenges we have in D&D, which is underwater combat. And when I came to him and said, you know, okay, you're just starting off, do you really want to try and manage vertical movement along with everything else? He said, yeah, I've got a system, don't worry about it. I'm going to get a little pole, I'm going to 3D print a platform, and I'm going to attach that to the pole, it'll slide up and down, it'll be great. And I was like, mind blown, because that's genius. I would never have come up with that. The last time I managed underwater combat, I was stacking little poker chips under the players. So I was like, a little bit of height, here's the next 5 feet, here's the next 5 feet. Whereas the system he came up with was like, here's 5 feet, here's the next 5 feet, here's the next 5 feet, here's the next 5 feet. And you can actually get a really good sense of a three-dimensional underwater battle space that has real height to it. And you're not having to use as much theater of mind. You can create a really cool representation on the battlefield. So as a crafter, I said, okay, that's great. I need to figure out how this can be done, because not only is it a tool that I wanted to have in my private toolbox, but I figured it would be an idea that would benefit you guys as well. So I want to give him full credit for this. He's amazing. I love him. And without further ado, let's go build his project.
We're going to start off by making some resin platforms out of this two-part epoxy. I've got some silicone molds that I'm going to pour this into. One is 3x3, one's 4x4. I've also got a little cup for mixing, and some paints that we're going to use to color this in. I'm also going to try inks, because this is my first time working with this. But before we get there, we're going to need to apply some mold release agent. In this case, I have some garden variety cooking spray. I put it on a little thick, so I came in and wiped out the excess before I started mixing. So, now that that's done, we're going to mix in equal parts of A and B. This may be different for your particular brand of resin. Make sure you read the directions and follow them as instructed. Here I am kind of a little too much B, so we're going to add in a little bit more A. But I have two molds ready to go, so in case I mix too much, I can go ahead and add the excess to the second one and then mix up another batch really quickly and make sure that they both get filled. You're going to want to keep stirring it until that swirl pattern in the middle goes away. Then, once you're ready, you're going to go ahead and slowly pour the resin into the molds. If you pour the resin too quickly, air bubbles may start to form in the resin. Now it's okay if we get one or two because we're doing an underwater setup. There are bubbles underwater. But we don't want too many bubbles so that it starts to look unnatural. So take your time and let the resin just flow out of your mixing container and into the mold. I came up a little short here, so I had to go and mix up just a little bit more to make sure I filled it out. Then, once I was done with that, I decided it was time to begin my color experiment. So for this first one, I mixed in two different blues that I got from Vallejo. These are true paints. So I just mixed them in and I figured, maybe this will create a cool little color dynamic. I've got the two different blues, add a little bit in the corners here and there, swirl it up, get a cool pattern. Maybe it'll come out nicely. For the other one, I decided to use Vallejo's blue ink instead. Inks are going to give us a more translucent finish, so I figured that might look cool too. Didn't know what these properties might do to the resin as it cured, so it was a big experiment for me. So I just made sure that I mixed in both thoroughly, and then left them to start curing. This process will generate fumes, so make sure you wear proper respiratory protection and work in a well-ventilated environment. I actually did most of my work for this project outside. I just pulled it into the workshop when I did various steps in order to film it so you guys could see things in the best light. Once you've let the resin start to harden, which could take anywhere from an hour to an hour and a half depending on environmental conditions like heat and humidity, you're going to want to come in with either a popsicle stick or a sculpting tool of some kind and begin to give yourself a little bit of a wave or ripple pattern on the resin platform. There'll still be enough give that you can carve it like I'm doing here, and I feel this gives it just a little bit more detail. You don't want to carve too deeply because then your models won't sit flat and they'll be in danger of tipping over if anything happens, but just adding these small little shapes will give it a nice detail. You may have to check in on it every once in a while just to make sure the pattern is sticking because, again, there's a lot of different factors that will affect the dry time of your resin. 48 hours later for me, which was the dry time of my resin, and we can pop it out of the mold. You can see that cooking spray worked really nice as a mold release agent. It's coming out nice and easy. And, you know, I really like the little bit of a wave powder that we got on there. I pushed a little bit of it up on the sides, which is that residue we've got along the edges, but you can really easily cut that off using a hobby knife. Now it's time to compare the ink versus the paint. The ink gave us this nice translucent blue and the tile's nice and hard, but the paint gave us still a nice color, but it's very bendy, so it looks like the resin didn't cure completely correctly since the paint was in there. So, you know, going forward, I'm gonna stick to just using the blue ink as opposed to the paint. With the platforms taken care of, now it's time to start building the apparatus they're going to be attached to. I started by cutting myself a 3.5-inch square base out of MDF board. If you're a gridded DM, you can cut this down to 3 inches, it won't be that bad, but I'm gridless, so 3.5 inches gave me a little bit more stability. Then, I grabbed my speed square and traced out to find the exact middle point of this piece. We're going to drill a hole in there to insert a dowel rod. I decided to use a 3/4-inch dowel rod because that's the measurement that matched up with all of my components. I'm not sure where the footage of me drilling the hole went, but here's the hole. The last thing to do was to come in with my orbital sander and bevel the edges. You can also do this with a craft knife or with sandpaper, but I really like using this tool. It gives me a lot of control and lets me come to a nice, clean edge with not very much effort on my part. To support our platform on the dowel rod, we're going to use these shaft collars. I got them for about $3 on Amazon. I'll leave a link in the video description. But the only thing that's bad about them is they come a little bit tight. So to loosen them up, you can just grab a screwdriver and a hammer and wedge them apart. They're nice and durable, this won't hurt them at all, but it's something you may have to do periodically just to make sure they stay loose. They do have a tendency to tighten up. It's the only flaw, but they give you a really firm grip, so I really like them as a support. However, when I compared my 3/4-inch dowel rod to my 3/4-inch shaft collar, they wouldn't quite fit together. So to fix this problem, I grabbed a belt sander. I took the dowel rod and just slowly rotated it to make sure that I got an even sanding along each side as I slightly reduced the diameter. I didn't need to reduce it too much, but I needed it just enough so that the shaft collar would slide up and down nicely without scratching the paint we were going to put on it. Make sure that you dry fit periodically to make sure that you don't sand off too much to the point where you can't get the shaft collar to lock on. Keep it slow, keep it steady, and you'll be done before you know it. Once the dowel rod was ready, I took some Gorilla Glue construction adhesive and added it to the bottom of the dowel and then put it into the base. I then came in with a plastic knife and just tried to force as much of the Gorilla Glue down into the gap as I physically could, trying to create as much surface area where there could be contact between the adhesive and the two components. Now it's time to start painting. I had some blue primer left over from some 4th of July decorations I made. So I came in and just primed it blue, and then came in with another blue craft paint just to make sure I had a really nice, thick base coat. Next, I came in with a lighter blue and began to stipple it in a random pattern. This is just going to break up the core blue, give it a little bit more visual interest, and simulate light shining through the water column, giving you slight variations in color. It was at this point that I noticed that one of my platforms had a little bit of a wiggle in it. I think this is because there wasn't enough surface area in the 1/4-inch MDF board to really make a good bond between that and the wooden dowel. So I decided if it's worth doing, it's worth overdoing, and I came in with some cement and cemented the pole in. I had this left over from some other projects where I picked it up, so it was readily available, and I knew it would give me a nice sturdy bond and really make sure that platform wasn't going anywhere. Once the concrete was set and I had blended it back into the rest of the structure, I came in and added some white PVA glue and spread it out evenly using an old paintbrush. This is going to help us glue on some flocking. My mixture for this was some beach sand, some tile grout, and a little bit of the concrete from before just to give us a little bit of variety in our particulate. Once it was dry, I came back to add a layer of Mod Podge just to really seal this in. You know, you never want dust falling off onto your gaming surface, so this little layer of sealant is just going to help keep all that stuff locked down so it doesn't make a mess. In order to make it so we don't have to measure everything while we're working in game, we're going to pre-measure our dowel rods and put some markings on there to show different elevations. I decided to go with 2 inches as my marking distance because I find that D&D miniatures are about 1.25 inches to 1.5 inches on average for the player characters. So I figured that would allow me to stack platforms nicely while still leaving room for the miniatures to be on each level. Now I drew the Sharpie around in this first part, But then, as I was recording the audio for this, someone pointed out that I could have wrapped painter's tape around it and gotten a much, much nicer finish. So, that's what I advise you guys to do. Two layers of painter tape, take a little bit of a brush around it, it'll give you a nice clean line. This last step is optional, but I thought it would look good if I came in and added some plastic aquarium plants around the base of the tower. This just gives it a little bit more life, little color, and a little more visual interest. You could do this to suit any kind of setting you have. This is obviously a little bit more tropical, but you could make it more rocky if you have something like the North Sea, or, you know, if you've got an Arctic Ocean, dead barren. So, just do whatever makes sense for your setting, or whatever you think just looks nice. Now it's time for a little demo. I've already attached the shaft collar, and I'm going to take my 4-inch platform that I've drilled through the center of and bring it down to make a platform. Then we can go in and add our miniatures. Here I've got one of my Idoneth attacking this Shakespearean bard in the middle of his alas poor Yorick moment. But he's now noticed the Idoneth and he wants to get away from her, so he's going to swim up to a higher elevation. So the first thing we're going to do is remove the platform like so, just lift it right up and off. You can take the models off beforehand, but both of these are my models. If I break them, you know, that's on me. Then I come in with my Allen wrench and loosen up the shaft collar. You want to make sure that it's completely loose so that when you raise it up, you don't scratch the paint at all. Here it didn't have quite enough give, so came in, gave it another quick turn, and then it went nicely up the pole. So there we go. I raise it up to the next level, and I come in and tighten it up to lock it back in place. Make sure you tighten it up all the way so that it doesn't end up sliding back down the pole so your models drop, fall off, do anything. So once you got it tightened, we just go ahead and put the platform back on. Get our miniatures back in position, and too easy, they've now both moved up in the water column. We can also come in and add another platform because, let's say, now he's going to get away for real this time. He's going to swim way away, take the dash action, and she's not going to follow him. So, as soon as we finish with this lovely shot of my arm for tightening this bolt, I'm going to come in and I'm going to add the 3-inch platform. I drilled the hole in the corner of this platform as opposed to the center just to give me some variety in case I need to extend over a piece of terrain that won't fit with the base, or I want to put a larger model in the air. That platform fits really nicely with my Achillean King, who has a 60mm base, so it's just something that's there to give you options. With the demo finished, all that's left are the glamour shots. I set up a little scene here where a band of adventurers are trying to fend off an attack by the Idoneth Deepkin. You can see how this system really is nice and versatile in creating a visual component to the battlefield you otherwise couldn't get. Whether it's my Achillean King overlooking the entire battlefield as he commands his men, or this brave Viking warrior staring face to face with the Eidolon of Mathlan. It's just a really great system. My cousin was absolutely groundbreaking in coming up with this, and I cannot thank him enough for inspiring this build. If you enjoyed this video, give us a like and subscribe to the channel to keep up to date on all of our future content. Also, if you know someone else who would like this video, please share it with them. I'd like to turn this channel into a community of crafters, and it's your support that motivates me to continue to expand my skill set and create new and exciting projects for you all. Thank you so much for watching, and I hope to see you again the next time we ignite the Forge of Sagas.